Assalamu alaikum viewers, please like, share and subscribe this channel. Links of PDF files used in this video are given in description. So today's lecture is about introduction to nanomaterials, and in this particular lecture we will elaborate the basic terminology that is used in the field of nanomaterials and nanoscience and technology. Nanoscience and technology is a broad and interdisciplinary area growing exclusively worldwide in the past few years. Nanomaterials are cornerstones of nanoscience and nanotechnology. Nowadays, in research and development, the major sectors are such as energy, environmental remediation, materials protection, surface disinfection, building materials, dental care, cosmetics, and pharmaceutical industries. Apart from these applications, the use of nanomaterials are enormous as energy storage devices such as in fuel cells, detection of threats in defense, navy, drug delivery and water purification. For example, if we see here, this is the diagram which is showing the working principle of the fuel cell. If you see here in this diagram that this is the hydrogen and it is passing through the anode. And at anode, it loses its electrons and is going through this anode in the form of H plus ions. Now this H plus ion is passed to the electrolytic membrane, whereas its electron is passing through the external circuit and it is operating that load, and then that electron is reaching finally at cathode. At cathode, the oxygen from the outside is accepting the electrons and is converted into O2 negative. So H plus ions from here and the oxide ions from here, they combine together to form the water molecules as the byproduct. So here we can see that this load is operated by the flow of electrons through this electrical circuit. Now what is important is that the nanotechnology is used in making of or fabrication of these anodes and electrolytic membranes and cathodes. There are enormous applications of nanotechnology in defense. For example, the advanced nanotech displays and the nanotechnology used in weapon system. For example, these weapons are light in weight and these can be used in any situation, in water or in any pressure of air. These advanced nanotechnology displays give the information like the moving target or some heat sensitive signal, etc. Similarly, the future soldier is totally the application of nanotechnology. For example, these head displays, these are used for enhanced situational awareness, provide critical data, light, it will provide the moving target. Similarly, the helmet, it is composed of nanotechnological material that it will be very hard to destroy and it will be very light in weight. Similarly, it will absorb moisture, etc. We have used solar panels in order to provide the energy. Biosensors, we have fabricated. These biosensors will give us the ready-made information like blood pressure, oxygen level, any vitals information, etc. Similarly, the body armor. This body armor will be again will be having a strength of steel, whereas it will be light as that of it is made up of carbon material. Similarly, the body of weapon, the body of the armor, similarly this leg brace, which is also using the movement kinetic energy, is stored, and it also provide the impact resistance. Similarly, the exoskeleton, which is light in weight and it helps in the movement so that the soldier doesn't fatigue in the harsh conditions. So if you see here, from toe to head, all of the defense applications are the product of nanotechnology. The nanotechnology also has been used in the discovery of new ways for drug delivery. Like the problem with cancerous diseases especially is that we have been able to make the effective drugs that are working very well in outside systems. But in vivo, these systems don't work because the drug is not delivered properly at the site. So by using the nanotechnology, we are now able to deliver our drug at the specific site with the effective quantity. So in this way, now there has been new technological advancements in the field of drug delivery, and this all is happening because of nanoscience, nanotechnology, and nano applications of this new field. Here is another application of nanotechnology, and we have made a special type of water purification system, and this water purification system is not using any electricity and it can be used in remote areas. So what we are seeing here, that this is the cap, this is the filter unit where the whole filtration system is occurring, and here the particular thing that has been developed with the help of nanotechnology, and that is the membrane. And this membrane is actually purifying the whole water system, and it is not removing only inorganic materials but organic materials, biological materials, etc. And then this is the storage device, and then this is the tap from which we can easily take up our water. So in this way, the nanotechnology has a lots of advances in water purification systems, and now even we can filter the seawater and we can make it use for human beings. Industrial level revolution has made life easy and pleasant. So today's high speed personal computers and mobile communications would not have certainly been possible without the use of nanoscience and nanotechnology. Now, after having a broad overview of what are the applications of nanotechnology, and we can see clearly that nanotechnology has been penetrated in every field of life. So now we will discuss some basic terminology of nanoscience and technology. So what is the definition of nanoscience and technology? So it is the science and technology which deals with the particles in size between 1 to 100 nanometer. So whenever we are dealing with particles of size 1 to 100 nanometer, it means we are using nanoscience and technology. So these are very minute dimensions, and we have further classified the nanomaterials on the basis of these nanometer dimensions. So if we see here that on the basis of reduction in size of material and dimensions, nanomaterials are classified into three main groups. Number one is three-dimensional things, number two two-dimensional things, and number three is one-dimensional things. All will be in lesser in size as compared to 100 nanometer. So three-dimensional things that are in nanometer range, these are called as nanoparticles and quantum dots. Two-dimensional things are called as nanotubes and nanowires and nanofibers, whereas one-dimensional things are called as nanofilms and coatings. Now one by one we will see what are the nanoparticles and quantum dots, nanotubes, nanowires, nanofibers, thin films and coatings. So here in this slide we are seeing here the nanoparticles and quantum dots. We are very familiar with quantum dots, as recently the latest Nobel Prize in chemistry has been awarded by the synthesis and discovery of quantum dots. These quantum dots are also called as Q dots, and the latest application of these dots is QLEDs. The reason for this is that if we see here that these all are quantum dots of various sizes, as we are seeing that as the size increasing, the color of this quantum dot is going from blue to red, and as we are making its size reduce, the color is going from red to blue. In this way we have created a rainbow of all types of colors from these dots, and these have lots of applications in the field of imaging and screens and in displays. So here we are seeing actually the two-dimensional nanomaterials, and these include nanotubes, nanowires and nanofibers. Actually, nanotubes are 3D things, such as very well-known materials is carbon nanotubes or CNTs, and these are used in lot of materials for providing strength, and its strength is equal to that of steel. Similarly, these are nanofibers and these are nanowires and these are nanofibers. The difference between nanofiber and nanowire is that nanowire is still thin as compared to the nanofiber. So these are actually the two-dimensional nanomaterials, and the one-dimensional nanomaterial is thin coatings and films. Here we can see that this is the material substrate and its surface has been coated with the nanomaterial. Actually, the surface contains the atoms, and these are one atom thick layers, so that is why these are called as thin films. And here is the example of thin coatings. So usually we have one or two layers of the atoms, so that is why these materials are called as one-dimensional nanomaterials. We have lot of applications of these thin films and coatings. The biggest advantage of this technology is that if we want to develop some material, then we don't need to fill the all material with the same. What we are doing is that we take a cheap substrate and on its surface we coat the thin films and coatings. In this way, that whole material behaves just like as the material will behave in its purest form. So in this way we can develop the properties by using the cheap materials and the with lesser quantity of the expensive material by coating that expensive material on that cheap material or substrate. So what is the application of this is that we are making the surface modified in the form of different atoms by using the nanotechnology. So in this classification scheme we have studied thin films and coatings, two-dimensional materials like nanotubes, wires and nanofibers, and three-dimensional materials like nanoparticles and quantum dots. So there is an other classification scheme in which we are not dealing with dimensions, but we are dealing with the number of pores or the size of pores on the materials. So this is another way of classification of nanomaterials, and we will further study here. So these materials which have their surface porous, these are called as nanoporous materials. Now these are further divided into three types. First of all is the microporous materials, then there is mesoporous materials, and then there is a macroporous materials or systems. So why we have studied this type of classification is that since most of the properties which are interesting for the applications of adsorption and diffusion are depending on this parameter. The prefix nano means a typical dimension between 1 and 100 nanometer. In this range, material properties change drastically. When materials interact with other molecules, in fact, pore diameter establishes the size of molecules that could diffuse inside the inside, and comparison between the pore size and the dimension of gas molecule gives an idea about diffusion and interaction properties. If the two dimensions are same, we can expect that the molecule wall interaction will be prevalent along with the molecule-molecule interaction. By the other way, if gas molecules are smaller than the pore size, then there will be less molecule wall interaction, or there will be a less molecular-molecular interaction. So according to IUPAC system, nanoporous materials are classified into three main groups depending upon the pore dimension. So first are called as microporous materials, and in this the diameter of that pore is actually less than 2 nanometer. These materials have varied nanopores. They can host only small molecules such as gases or linear molecules, and generally show slow diffusion kinetics and high interaction properties. They are generally used in gas purification systems, membrane filters, or gas storage materials. The application of these materials is such as sodium and yttrium and naturally occurring clay materials. Like if we see here, these are the structures of different sodium, yttrium and claying materials, and these have these nanopores which are smaller in size, and that is less than 2 nanometer in diameter. So second type is mesoporous materials, and they have dimension that is greater than diameter of 2 nanometer but less than 50 nanometer. These materials have pores with diameter size enough to host some big molecules, and these big molecules include aromatic systems or polymeric monomers. Diffusion kinetics of the absorbed molecules is often due to the capillarity with an initial interaction with the pore wall formed by the pore filling. These systems can be used for nanoreactors for the polymerization, or absorbing systems for liquids or vapors. Like the surface of these pores provide the entry of large molecules, and on the surface of these materials we can perform various types of chemical reactions. So the example of these is these materials, including carbon mesoporous materials. And the third type is macroporous system, and pores of these materials could host a very large molecule such as polyaromatic systems or small biological molecules. So overall, in this case, there are interactions, and these materials are principally used as matrices to store functional molecules, as scaffolds to graft functional groups such as catalytic centers, and as sensing materials thanks to the diffusion of the chemical species in the pore system. The important word in this all paragraph is that these materials act as scaffolds. Actually, scaffolding means due to these pores we have arranged molecules with each other. Now what we are doing is that we are making them at a particular angle and at a particular distance, and when the molecules come so much with interaction, then we destroy these porous material, and it will just like as a scaffold, and we will remove this scaffold and whole molecule will remain attached with each other, and a nanostructure material will be formed like this by removing that scaffold. It is just like we are constructing a home, and when we make a granite roof, then what we are doing is that in order to support that roof, we are holding pillars, but after getting strength we remove those pillars. Now these pillars are scaffolds. Just like that, we also use porous gels and porous glasses to make the nanomaterial, and after that nanomaterial is arranged, we then remove these scaffolds, and in this way our new nanomaterial is synthesized. So in this way we have macroporous systems, mesoporous systems, and then microporous systems, and in this way this is another way of classification of nanomaterials. I hope you have well understood this lecture, but if you have any question, let me know in the comments. I will respond as soon as possible. Okay, thank you. Allah Hafiz.